animal linguistics, animal grammar. We've spent 6 videos wondering whether various species' signals count as word-like and grammatical. Well, what about humans? What can animal communication tell us about our languages? And do we learn anything useful, or dare I say hypocritical, about the way we talk about other animals talking or not talking? Together, we've tiptoed into animal linguistics, looking for whatever grammar we might find among these species. Who are we comparing them to when we optimistically declare a species grammarful or scrutinize them as grammarless? Let's turn things around on that most properly grammatical of animals. Humans take small, meaningless units, build them into meaningful parts and words, into sentences, into conversations and discourses. From trained apes to wild grammars, we've sought out parallels to each of those. This alone is a stretch for linguists, being willing to extend terminology like syllables, meaning, words, affixes, and sentences to non-humans. But since we did take that step and ask what's human about animal communication, I obviously have to wonder, well then, what's animal about human communication? Look, in my grammanimal spreadsheet, humans aren't at the top. We're just another row alongside everyone else. Yet you know my channel, though I have made exceptions for migrating crops and communicating animals, is about human languages and cultures. Given that bias and background, it'll be hard for me to fill out just one critter profile sheet on humans, and maybe add a footnote like see rest of channel. So while I figure out what to write on here, instead of regurgitating my mess of notes and sources, I'll sum up a story of 6 guys who, while studying up for this, helped me see and hear humans alongside other critters. A real guys club here. The first challenged, my human language will be a headache for us, Evo-Devo-wise. The next replied, no, we'll find an explanation if we don't needlessly anthropomorphize. Third is a linguist, musician, ponderer of eclectic topics from puns to animals. He fishes outside of humanity for a list of 13 features missing from at least one non-human system. It's short, cited throughout my sources, but I've done a video before and won't rehash here. What's less mentioned is how his paper meanders to where so much of the discussion always seems to end up: the origins of human language. In conjectural but coherent psychology-riddled stories. From 2 T-names, I read 2 books with contrasting views. One tells us how we took grammar from the iconic to the arbitrary, as social cooperation pushed us to build up from simple requests to serious information to fancy narration, not by following rules, but out of dynamic group norms. The other, well, remember Nim Chimpsky's debunker? He dangles out an origins argument of his own that language follows a need for calories, foraging, and social bonds, and therefore a need for declaratives. To fit that world, human words developed before human grammar. This lineup ends with a name from my Zeros video who's really into languages of Indonesia. Ambling among philosophical thorns not all linguists love, but animal authors seem to, he turns the tables on us with this table of compositionality for finding grammar in any species. It's a wholes greater than sum of parts sort of thing, but basically, break down meaningful wholes into meanings of parts and structure of parts to study all forms of language. His example. You hear a sports announcer repeating, call-like, a player's name over and over again, faster, then suddenly held out louder and higher pitched. Were they moving towards or away from the goal? Did they miss or score? What cues did you use to determine that? It's one thing to set human calls and signals alongside all other animals. Well, then we can do animal communication things, like reflect on whether we communicate fundamentally because we want to pass information to one another, or because we're trying to influence each other. But why not take the next step? Turn the tables all the way around. Put us through the same tests. Think back to when I mentioned orangutans and apparently satisfactory outcomes. One paper reports the successful use of ASOs to infer human meaning, too. But orangutan ASOs were limited to commands, and humans aren't. Be fair, test you and me on declaratives, and our outcomes might likewise be apparently unsatisfactory. See, ASOs mostly detect imperatives, so we bumped up against a methodological limit, not an orangutan limit. So which limits aren't methodological? Well, after much chatter about animal chatter, one paper cited a couple times in my readings asks why the humans escaped grammatical scrutiny. Brush aside assumptions of specialness, null hypothesis, we're yet another non-linguistic animal species. Run the tests on us. How do we fare? It's claimed we're caught missing the capacity for semantics, syntax, even vocal learning. Maybe humans rise to the level of having language, but we just can't detect it in them yet. Await further research. Provocative. And leaves us teetering on historically iffy implications, indulging in speculation, or something this channel is not about, biologizing languages and cultures, at least without ecologizing first. Still, now that I've appreciated Homo sapiens from the animal communication angle, maybe I can finally ink up that journal page. While I do, I'm left wondering if there aren't rough parallels for most grammatical points scattered across animals, and how much they actually share with human calls and signals. With at least one big exception, creativity. Whether you argue grammar is about bottomless compositionality, enter the word recursion we'll meet again, or about limitless functions of language, limitless influence or limitless information, even sympathetic voices I've read admit that we haven't detected any other language-like system with such endless structured creativity. We've now met hypotheses about why, asking if it arose from earlier foraging or scavenging, if it grew from requesting to informing to narrating, if it started with words or with grammar. But all this guesswork comes down to cooperative, complex social bonds. However, there is suspicion that less and more distantly related chordates show precisely these kinds of strong social bonds, along with surprising grammar-like abilities. So, what about whales and birds? Next time. Thanks for watching. And thanks, patrons, for making this possible. Another reminder about my sources document, since I spent a long time on it, and my Grammanimal spreadsheet for more species and system-specific info, including some that didn't make it into the final animations. Stick around and subscribe for one more about animals for now, and many more about languages.